Now we are going to start with the next chapter of particle accelerators. So we have already discussed about the radiation detectors which are used to detect the ionizing particle which is entering the detector. Now in a nuclear reaction we have seen that high energetic particles are used. So we have already seen that high energetic particles are made to bombard and a nuclear reaction is made to happen. So how these particles, they gain so much of kinetic energy, how these particles, they attain so much of energy that a nuclear reaction can occur. So these particles, they attain so much of this high amount of energy through these particle accelerators. So particle accelerator is a device that produces forces on charged particles by some combination of electric and magnetic fields. So some combination of electric and magnetic field is used in these devices that we will see in the next few lectures. And this force, it brings the ions to high speed and increased kinetic energy. So you can see that I have talked about electric field. So we know that electric field accelerates a charge. So if a charge is present inside an electric field, a force will occur on that charge and hence it will get accelerated. So particles, they are accelerated to high speeds through the combination of electric and magnetic fields, and these are called as accelerators. So the simplest way to increase the energy of a charged particle is to allow the particle beam to move through a high electric potential difference. So we can make the particle beam to pass through a high electric potential difference. High electric potential difference means there will be high electric field intensity. So using the electric field, we can make the particle beam to move with the high velocity, to attain high velocity. And these accelerators are termed as electrostatic accelerators. And why they are called as electrostatic? In this case, the voltage between the electrodes, the voltage difference between the electrodes remain constant with time. So it does not change with time. Therefore, we call these accelerators as the electrostatic accelerator. So using this potential difference between the electrodes, we can accelerate the charged particles. So the two examples that we are going to discuss that come under electrostatic accelerators, first is So the first one is Cockcroft-Walton accelerator, and second one is Van de Graaff generator. So this is also called as Cockcroft-Walton generator, and the second one is Van de Graaff generator. So these accelerators, they have a constant voltage difference between the electrodes through which the charged particles are accelerated. Now after this, we have the concept of using electric fields that change with time. So over here, the voltage difference, it remains the same. The electric field intensity is constant in between the electrodes. But after that came the concept that we can use the electric fields that change with time. Means the electric field oscillates. The electric field oscillates in resonance with the particles passing through the accelerating gaps. So these accelerating gaps you might have done in your high school in the case of cyclotron. So in the case of cyclotron, you might have studied that you have two D's which are made up of conductor, and the charged particle is made to revolve inside this region in circular fashion, and this is the gap between the two D's and this is the accelerating gap. So whenever the charged particle is present, it comes in this gap, it gets accelerated, and this acceleration is in resonance with the electric field, because the electric field which we have applied that oscillates, and that electric field must oscillate in resonance with the particle passing through the accelerating gap. Means as soon as the particle comes in this gap, it must be accelerated through the electric field which we have applied, through the oscillatory electric field we have applied. So these accelerators, they come under oscillating field accelerators. So here we use the electric field that oscillates. So the first example is LINAC, the linear accelerator. So in this case, we use electric field that oscillates and the particle is accelerated in the accelerating gaps. But as its name suggests that this is a linear accelerator, so there is no magnetic field that we have applied. But in this case, we have other accelerators in which we use magnetic field. And what is the work of magnetic field? As you know that if you have certain magnetic field present in a region and a charged particle enters this region in which magnetic field is present, so this charged particle starts moving in a circular orbit. So this starts moving in a circular orbit. So in these accelerators, if you do not use magnetic field, then you have to accelerate the charge in a linear fashion. And that comes under LINAC. So that we will also study in the next lectures. So the other accelerators like the cyclotron, synchrotron, in those accelerators we use magnetic field also so that the particle can be accelerated in a small region. Because if you are accelerating a particle in a linear fashion, then the equipment that you require, the space that you require will be very large. But if you confine the particle in a small region using the magnetic field, in that case, the amount of equipment required will be less. So that is the advantage. That is one of the advantages of using magnetic field. Because magnetic field makes the particle to move in a circular fashion, and the electric field that you apply, that accelerates the charged particle. So in a small region itself, we can increase the velocity, we can increase the energy of a charged particle, and hence they can be accelerated. Whereas in the case of linear accelerators like LINAC, the amount of equipment required is large. So firstly, we are going to discuss about Cockcroft and Walton accelerator. So John Cockcroft and Ernest Walton developed a particle accelerator, which is known as Cockcroft-Walton generator or Cockcroft-Walnut accelerator. And this accelerator is based on the technique of voltage multiplication. This accelerator comes under the electrostatic accelerator. So a constant voltage will be obtained. That voltage will not change with time. So constant voltage is obtained between the two electrodes, and that voltage does not change with time. So this accelerator comes under electrostatic accelerators, and this is based on the technique of voltage multiplication. So the output voltage that we get is integral multiple of the input voltage. So in an accelerator, we want to increase the energy of a charged particle, and energy of a charged particle will get increased if the potential difference is more. And the potential difference can be increased using the concept of voltage multiplication. So this generator uses a rectifier circuit. So that we will see that it uses a rectifier circuit producing a DC output. So we will have an AC input. So the rectifier circuit will produce a DC output, and that DC output that we will get, the output voltage, the DC output voltage that we will get across the electrodes will be integer multiplied by the AC peak input. So we will apply AC voltage. So AC voltage will be applied. Let's say its peak value is V naught, and in the negative direction it is minus V naught. So what will be the net output voltage that you get in this accelerator? That voltage will be equal to integer times the AC peak input. So the voltage gets multiplied by an integral value. So this voltage source, this accelerator, was connected to an accelerator tube. So if you have a large voltage difference, if you obtain a large voltage difference, that voltage difference can be applied to an accelerator tube to accelerate protons. So this device was used when it was first used by Cockcroft and Walton. This was connected to an accelerator tube to accelerate protons. So protons were accelerated using this device for the first time. Now let's see its principle. So as I have said that it works on the principle of voltage multiplication. Now this device is made up of voltage multiplier ladder network of capacitors and diodes. As you can see in this diagram, you have capacitors, you have C1 capacitor, then C2 capacitor, C3, C4, C5, C6. So this is a ladder network, and also you have diodes. So this is the diode D1, this one is D2, D3, D4, D5 and so on. So this is a ladder network of capacitors and diodes to generate high voltages. So that we will see in few minutes, that how high voltage is generated using this network. Now the capacitors, these capacitors, they are charged in parallel and they get discharged in series. So these capacitors, they are attached to these electrodes of the accelerator tube. So this is the accelerator tube. So as we have said that the voltage source, the high voltage that you obtain from this construction, that voltage is connected to the accelerator tube where we can accelerate the charged particles. So these capacitors, the two terminals, they are attached to the respective electrodes. So these shown over here, these are the electrodes. So this is connected over here, this one is connected over here. And they get discharged in series. So you have some resistance attached like this. And this one is grounded over here. So these capacitors, they get charged in steps, they get charged in parallel and they get discharged in series. Now the output voltage across them, the total output voltage that you get, that is sum of the voltages on every individual capacitor discharged in series. So you will see that the total output voltage will be equal to the voltage across C2 plus the voltage across C4 plus the voltage across C6, then plus the voltage across C8. So this network, it can go to n number of stages. So this is the first stage I have drawn. This one is the first stage up to this point. So up to this second diode, this is the first stage, and up to this fourth diode, you have two stages, and up to this sixth diode you have three stages, and so on. So you can have n number of stages. As you increase the number of stages, the output voltage that you get will also increase. So the total output voltage is obtained at this point, and let's suppose if you have four stages, so these are the four stages. So let's say if you have only four stages, then this will be the second terminal and this one will be the first terminal. So between these two terminals you will get the net output voltage, and that net output voltage will be just the summation of voltage across C2, C4, C6 and C8. So we will see in the working that the voltage across C2 will be twice of V0. So if V0 is the peak of the input voltage, then across this C2 the voltage will be twice of V naught. Then across the C4, the voltage will be twice of V naught, and across C6 also it will be twice of V naught, and so on. So the voltage gets multiplied. So the total voltage between this terminal and this terminal will be equal to 2V naught plus 2V naught plus 2V naught plus 2V naught. That will be equal to 8V naught. So the voltage has got multiplied. So the peak voltage at the secondary windings of the transformer, so this is the primary winding, and this input voltage, this is at the secondary windings. So if the peak input voltage at the secondary windings is V naught, and if you have four stages, then you have seen that the total output voltage, the DC output voltage, will be equal to 8 times V naught. So you can see that the voltage has increased, it has multiplied. So let's see the working of this generator. Now in the first diagram, I have shown only the first stage, and in the second diagram I have shown the two stages. So firstly, we will see how the voltage across C2 becomes equal to twice of V naught. So let's say this is the S1 point and this one is the S2 point. So these two points are across the secondary windings of the transformer. So the voltage between S1 and S2 varies between plus V naught and minus V naught. So we have applied AC voltage. So let's say that this is the input at the secondary windings, and the peak voltage is plus V naught, and in the negative cycle it can be minus V naught. So let's consider the first negative half cycle. So in this one stage, so we have only drawn the first stage. So in this first stage, we are considering the negative peak, the negative half cycle. So if we are considering the negative half cycle, then this S1 terminal will be negative and this S2 terminal will be positive. Means the potential at S1 will be less with respect to the potential at S2. So let's consider that we have peak voltage V naught. So the voltage difference is equal to V naught over here. So the voltage will be increasing and decreasing, but we are just supposing that we are in the first negative half cycle. And let's suppose that the voltage difference between S1 and S2 is equal to minus V naught. So potential at S1 is less with respect to the potential at S2. So this is what we mean by first negative half cycle. And if we will consider the positive half cycle, in that case, the potential at S1 will be greater with respect to the potential at S2. So that will be an opposite thing. So we are considering the first negative half cycle. So if this terminal is negative and this terminal is positive, then we have two capacitors and we have two diodes in the circuit. So if this terminal is negative, you can see that this D2 diode will be reverse biased. So this will not work. And you can see that the p-type of D1 diode is attached to the positive terminal. It is attached to S2, and S2 is positive in the case of first negative half cycle. So this diode will conduct. So current will pass, the current will flow only in this circuit, and D2 diode will be reverse biased, means this circuit will be open. So no current will pass through D2. So current will pass through this circuit, and due to the flow of the current, C1 capacitor will start charging. So let's consider that we are moving in the clockwise direction in this loop. In this loop itself, only in this loop we are moving in the clockwise direction, and in the ideal situation we are considering that voltage drop across D1 is equal to 0. So we want to find out what is the voltage drop, the voltage across C1. So what is the voltage across C1? So we already know that the voltage across the secondary winding is equal to V naught. So we are only considering the peak voltage over here. And let's say X is the voltage across C1, and we want to find out the value of X. So if in this loop, if you are moving in the clockwise direction using the Kirchhoff's voltage law, so if you are moving in the clockwise direction, so in these secondary windings you are moving from positive towards negative, so that voltage you will take as negative. So if you are moving from positive towards negative, you will take that voltage as negative. And if you are moving from negative towards positive, then that voltage you will take as positive. But in this case, we are moving in the clockwise direction in this loop, and you are going from positive towards negative. So you can clearly see that you are going from positive towards negative, and voltage drop is equal to V0. So if you are going from positive towards negative, that voltage you will take as negative. So you have minus V0, and then you are moving from S1 towards this point through C1. So what is the voltage across C1, the voltage difference across C1? We have supposed it equal to X. So let's say that is equal to X, and I am considering that this plate is negatively charged and this one is positively charged. So when you are moving in the clockwise direction, you are moving from the negative plate towards the positive plate, so I have taken it as plus X. And then you are going through the diode D1, and voltage across the diode D1 is supposed to be equal to 0, and summation of all these voltages must be equal to 0. So this is what we have in Kirchhoff's voltage law. The summation of all voltages in a closed loop comes out to be equal to 0. So what will be the value of X? X will come out to be equal to V0. So X has come out to be equal to plus V0, means the assumption that I made that the left hand side plate is negatively charged and the right hand side plate is positively charged, that convention was correct, that assumption was correct. So X has come out to be equal to V0, means the voltage across C1 is equal to V0. Now we are going to consider the positive half cycle. So in the first negative half cycle, the first capacitor gets charged to V0 voltage. Now what happens in the positive half cycle? So in the case of positive half cycle, so I am drawing the diagram again. So the capacitor has already charged to V0 voltage, and then you have a diode. Now we want to find out the voltage across the capacitor C2. So in the positive half cycle, this S1 will be positive with respect to S2. So S2 can be considered as negative. So potential at S1 will be greater with respect to the potential at S2. So if S2 is negative, you can see that this diode will be reverse biased. Earlier, this diode was forward biased when we were talking about negative half cycle. In the case of positive half cycle, this diode will be reverse biased and this diode will be forward biased. So you can see that positive is connected to P-type. So this positive is connected to P-type. So this diode will conduct, but this diode will not conduct. So you can ignore this diode. Now you have second loop over here. So earlier you had this first loop. Now you are going to move in the second loop. So you are going to move in this direction, in the clockwise direction again. So in this case, you will find out the expression of the value of voltage across C2. So let's suppose that this plate is positively charged and this one is negatively charged. So let's assume that this is the case. Now voltage across the secondary windings is equal to V0 because this is the input peak voltage. So when you are moving in the clockwise direction, now let's apply the Kirchhoff's voltage law. So when you are moving through these secondary windings, you are going from negative towards positive, so you will write it as plus V0, and then you are moving through this capacitor, so you are moving from negative towards positive, so plus V0. So voltage across this capacitor is equal to V0. So that we have already found. Then You are moving through this diode, and this diode is considered to be the ideal diode. So voltage drop across this diode is equal to zero. Now when you are moving through this capacitor C2, let's say the voltage across this capacitor is equal to Y, and we want to find out the value of this Y. So when you are moving from positive towards negative, you are going to take the voltage as negative. So you will take minus Y, and then you will have equal to zero. So summation of all the voltages will be equal to zero. So from this expression, you will find out Y comes out to be equal to twice of V0. So we have seen that Y comes out to be twice of V0 means this assumption that we made, that the right hand side plate is positively charged and the left hand side is negatively charged, this one is correct. But if the voltage comes out to be minus 2V0, so if you will take the assumption that the left hand side plate is positively charged and the right hand side plate is negatively charged, so if you take that example, in that case Y will come out to be equal to minus 2V0, means that the assumption that you have made is opposite. So you have to change the assumption to this situation only, means the right hand side plate is positively charged and the left hand side plate is negatively charged. So if this value comes out to be negative, means you have taken the completely opposite assumption of the polarities. So Y comes out to be 2V0 means the voltage across this C2 comes out to be twice of V0. So this is the first stage of the accelerator. So this one is the first stage, and we have seen that in this first stage, the voltage across C2 comes out to be twice of V0. And this plate is positively charged, this one is negatively charged. Now in the similar fashion, you can find out the voltage across this capacitor and then the voltage across this capacitor. So for that, again, you can take the next negative half cycle. So if you take the next negative half cycle, means this one is negative and this one is positive. So the voltage across the secondary windings is equal to V0. So if you take this case, you have already seen that the voltage across the first capacitor is equal to V0. The voltage across the second capacitor is equal to twice of V0. Now if you want to find out the voltage across this capacitor, then you have to move in the third loop. So here we first considered this first loop, and then we considered the second loop, and now in this case you will consider this third loop, means this capacitor and this third diode, then this capacitor and this closed third loop. So if you will move in this loop, let's suppose that this plate is negative and this plate is positive and the voltage is equal to Z, and you are moving in this direction. So you are moving in the clockwise direction again in this loop. So when you are moving, firstly consider the secondary windings. So you are moving from positive towards negative, means minus V0. Then you are moving from negative towards positive, means plus V0. And then you are moving again from negative towards positive, means plus Z. And after that, you are moving through this diode. The voltage across this diode will be zero. And then you are going from plus to negative. The positive towards negative means minus twice of V0. And that will be equal to zero. So this one will cancel with this one. So Z will come out to be twice of V0. So the voltage across this capacitor will be twice of V0. And you can see that it has come out to be equal to positive 2V0, means the assumption that we made, that the left hand side plate is negative and the right hand side plate is positive, that assumption is correct. Now in the similar manner, you can take the fourth loop, means the positive half cycle. So in the case of positive half cycle, this one will be positive and this one will be negative, and this diode will conduct. So you will take the fourth loop. So if you will take this fourth loop, you can find out the potential difference across the fourth capacitor, and you will see that it will come out to be twice of V naught. So we have seen in the case of first stage that the voltage across the C2 capacitor has come out to be twice of V naught. The input voltage, input peak voltage, was equal to V naught, and the output voltage across this C2 is equal to twice of V naught. So the voltage difference has doubled, and this arrangement is called as voltage doubler. So this arrangement is called as voltage doubler. This is used to double the input voltage. So if you will take the voltage across the C2, if you will measure the voltage across C2, that will come out to be twice of the input peak voltage across the secondary windings. So if you will take the second stage into account, you can see that the voltage across this capacitor has come out to be twice of V naught. So now if you will take this terminal and you take this terminal, so you can clearly see that the voltage difference between these two terminals will be 2V naught plus 2V naught, that will be equal to 4V naught. And in a similar manner, if you will take the third stage, so if you will take the third stage, means you will get another capacitor, and voltage across this capacitor will come out to be twice of V naught again. Then if you will take the voltage difference across this point and this point, then the net voltage difference, the net DC output voltage you will get, will be equal to 2V naught plus 2V naught plus 2V naught, that is equal to 6V naught. So if you will have three stages, you will get output voltage is equal to 6V naught. So in this manner, we can increase the voltage difference, and that net DC output voltage is applied across the accelerating tube, and hence the charged particles can be accelerated in that tube, which are then made to hit the target, and they are made to make a nuclear reaction. So if you will have, let's say if you have n stages, so what will be the net DC output voltage? That will be equal to twice of n times the peak input voltage. So if you have only single stage, means if you have only this arrangement, in that case the voltage across this capacitor will be equal to 2V naught. So n will be equal to 1. And if you have three stages, as we have seen, the voltage difference that you obtain is equal to 6V naught. So n will be equal to 3, means you have 3 stages. So the net DC output voltage that you get will be equal to 2 into 3 into V naught, that will be equal to 6V naught. So in this manner, this arrangement was made by Walton and Cockcroft, and they showed that using the electrostatic field, we can accelerate the charged particle.